Welcome to all the participants. We will wait some seconds because the people is starting to come to the meeting room. 60. The number is growing very fast, and then just we will wait some seconds more. Okay, it's 3:02, and it's time for new webinar organized through the in the framework of the WMO Sun and Desert Storm Warming Advisor and Advisory System, and mostly for is coordinated by the Barcelona Regional Center, that is the center that is hosting the activities of the region of Northern Africa, Middle East, and Europe. And today with me is chairing this session, Estelios Kasatzis, that is part of the SAC of aerosols of WMO and also was part of the cost action in dust that was the starting point of these webinars. And also my vice leader and also vice chair of the SDS was regional steering group, Slodovan Nikovic, a well-known researcher in the community of the aerosols. And just I want to welcome you to this new webinar and just remember some technical stuff about the platform. This is a Zoom webinar. This means that it's not a meeting, then you have limited access to the panelists today. Then to launch your questions and your comments, you have two ways to access us. It's the questions and answers box that is in the bottom of your screen, and you can type there all your questions during the webinar. Don't wait until the end because it's easier for us to handle and manage all your comments and questions during the webinar. But also you have the chat where you can put there any technical issue or if you have any technical problem with your connection, we will try to support you. And I hope that you will follow all the event with no problems. And just, I am Sara Bazart. I forgot to introduce myself. And I am part of the regional center. And also I'm part of the SDS Works program. And today I'm super glad to introduce our speaker. I think that he doesn't need any introduction because he's a well-known researcher in the community, is Paul Ginoux. Thanks a lot, Paul, to be here today and to accept our invitation. And he's a dust modeler, but not just modeler. He's also one of the reference of the dust modeling community because the work that he did in the past for the mapping of the sources and also to the constraint of the dust and the natural and the anthropogenic sources that produce dust at global scale. He's based in the States in the GFDL in NOAA, he has a long curriculum full of grants and awards and recognitions, and probably I think that is not necessary more introduction that only to thank again your acceptance. And I have to say that for me is one of the best speakers because the skills that he has is really nice. And with it, Paul, I will give you the floor to the talk.
That thank you, Sarah.
Will suffer some typos or some corrections in the title. Then.
So thank you, Sarah, for the invitation. And before I start, I would like to acknowledge some of my colleagues and friends who helped me providing some reprint of hard to find papers, Joe Prospero, Tom Gill, Matt Baddock, and Rob Bryan. And because of this hard to find paper, I had to change the title from a quarter century of the source detection from space to half. And so I will start. Okay, I have not figured out how this works. Okay, so what are we talking about dust source? So for this presentation, dust source represent areas with actual past and future active mineral dust emission from the Earth's surface during part of the year. I am not talking about Mars where dust is very important. I'm talking here about the Earth's surface. So the question I am going to ask is, where are they located and what are their characteristics? Using satellite data is the best option to answer this question because they offer global coverage with good to excellent temporal and spatial resolution. On the other hand, retrieve properties are often column integrated quantities from the surface to the satellite, which can be unrelated to the surface. Your dust plume can be elevated and also are subject to uncertainty due to the retrieval algorithm. So there are other methods which have been used in place or in conjunction with this satellite retrieval. So the outline of my talk is, first, I will mention the dust interaction with the Earth climate system, because if we do all this work, it's really to better understand this interaction with climate. And so I will then speak about the modeling, because models are the best tools to look at this interaction. And but if you want to use this model, first things you need to do is to find out and provide to the model the dust source, an inventory of the dust source. And also you need to provide their characteristics. Then I will speak about the satellite data to detect dust source, giving the pioneering work, then a history of these instruments, and then show some key results from the EVHRR, TOMS, and MODIS sensors. Then I will speak about the, explain some study which have been using different identification and attribute methods, in particular the inverse modeling, back trajectories, geomorphology, radiogenic isotopes, associated tracers, and mineralogy. And I will finish my talk by speaking about future perspectives. So what are the dust interaction in the climate systems? So mineral dust are emitted from the surface and then are uplifted in the atmosphere, where they can react with ozone on the surface with heterogeneous reaction. And you will have a coating by different acids like sulfuric and HNO3. And then, so this will affect photochemistry, ozone photochemistry. Then this dust particle will be transported in the atmosphere, where you will have a condensation of ice, and it will be the prelude, the initiation of ice cloud. They will eventually, because they are relatively large, they are about, they are less than 20 micrometers, but by gravity, they will settle and sediment to the surface where they can fertilize the soil. Others will be transported by convective clouds, where they will be detrained at a higher elevation, and they will scatter and absorb solar radiation, which will heat or cool the atmosphere. Other will deposit by convective clouds, precipitating cloud and forming snow. And because they are generally darker than the snow, they will increase the snow melting. Others will be transported over the ocean, where they will deposit either by dry deposition or wet precipitating clouds, where they will provide key nutrients for ocean biogeochemistry, which this phytoplankton blooming will be a sink for carbon dioxide. So this interaction with the different component of the Earth system will feed back on the dust source and will modify this dust source. So you have climate interaction affecting the dust source. This is called a feedback. And so to include and study and understand this interaction and feedbacks, you need climate models. But first, let's look at the different factors affecting the variability of this dust source. You have on one part expanding factors like drought, land use, human activity, and wildfires. On the other side, you have shrinking factor. Land can be abundant, farmland can be abundant, urban area can be abundant, and you have vegetation grow. And then you have irrigation, which will increase soil moisture and decrease dust emission. And you have reforestation. So clearly the source vary in time. They can appear or disappear due to both. It's important to understand that climate or land use change, so a natural variability or human anthropogenic factors. So if we look at 20,000 years ago during the last glacial maximum, dust was 10 to 100 times more abundant than now. And one major source was exposed continental shelf because the sea surface was about 150 meters lower. And so the continental shelf was exposed and was producing a lot of dust. But now these are submerged. And so we don't have this kind of source. Also, a anthropogenic factor, it's the dust bowl of the 30s. So in the United States high plain, there were major dust storms which farmer moving to the California, and it was associated by a combination of drought and agricultural practice, which have changed, hopefully. And then, but now, actually, I am in south of southwest of France here near Toulouse, and I am speaking of farmer. And so this is happening now due to economic hardship. Farmers are abandoning pasture and rangeland, which will increase fuel for wildfires because we have drought here, producing new bare surface subject to dust emission. And with my colleague Ginoux, a professor at Beijing University, we submit this paper and hopefully it will be published soon. So we need model to include all these different interaction and feedbacks. And so I am showing you here what we have at GFDL, which is, I think, one of the best, more comprehensive model for the dust life cycle. And so we have different compounds. So we represent in an Earth system model, the model represents the different compounds, which are the land, the atmosphere, the ocean, the ice, and they interact, speak to each other through a mathematical formula, and they are, this formula are resolved numerically on supercomputer. So let's start by the land. So this model, this land model is has a unique feature is that it includes variability due to land use change. So you can have scenario and going from deforestation to a cropland, moving back to a grassland. And then it includes climate change. So you can go from a temperate forest to arid area or even desertification due to drought. Or in the opposite, when you have increase of precipitation, you can move from an arid region to a more temperate or semi-arid region. And so all of that is simulated by the GFDL land model with the group there, which is doing a fantastic job, I have to say. And so each of these tiles, because this is within one point of the model, you subdivide in the different category of land. Dust emission flux are calculated for each tile independently and then exchanged to the atmosphere, sent to the atmosphere, where it will interact, as I mentioned, all this interaction with radiation, clouds, ocean photochemistry are included. And then they will deposit in over the ocean, where they will be transported in the ocean, my dust particles are transported in the ocean, where they will be eaten, disappear by zooplankton and producing phytoplankton. So the ocean greening of the surface is phytoplankton, which will feed the zooplankton and then the fish and so on. So all of this cycle is entirely simulated in the GFDL model. And so we can look at the interaction between these different compounds and also feedback on this land and dust emission. So now we need to feed this model with the source. Where are they? And so here I give the history of the different sensors which have been used to detect the source and also their characteristics. So, and this is, this slide is because I changed the title of my slides to half a century. So to the origin of this, the zero is the Sputnik launch in 1957. It was not used for dust. Then the Americans were in a hurry and were able to launch a satellite on 1958, then they realized that satellite would be essential to understand weather and so predict where, for example, hurricanes or tornadoes would be. And so they launched the first meteo satellite, which is Terros 1. And then the Environmental Science and Service Administration, which will later be NOAA, for which I work, launched a satellite in 1967, which will be used. This is the first time a photo from a satellite is used to detect the dust zone. Then NASA launched Landsat. All these satellites have been used for dust detection. Then Landsat by NASA with four bands in 72, the NOAA with AVHRR sensor, Nimbus 7 TOMS. So I will speak about AVHRR TOMS. A very interesting sensor is polder by the French because it includes polarization and dust is polarizing light. So this sensor is very useful to detect dust. Then we have the NISR and MODIS sensor that I have used widely to detect the source. And then the OMI instrument, which is a successor of the TOMS, and then again, polarizing instrument, by the French, Parasol, and then a LIDAR in space. So this, you have a LIDAR, which is orbiting the Earth and measuring all the aerosol, the vertical profile of aerosol since 2006, and it's still flying there. So this is extraordinary data set. And then more recently, there is a MODIS type instrument called VIRS, and then the Europeans and another OMI or TOM sensor. So these are polar orbiting, which means that they are rotating over the Earth with an angle. And so they are passing it takes about 90 minutes to do an orbit. And meanwhile, the Earth is rotating. And so they measure over 2,000 kilometers, about 2,000 kilometers wide. And so while the Earth is turning, so at the end of the day, they can measure, they can sense, detect all the aerosol over the globe in one day. But you have another type, which is geostationary. It's observing always the same area on Earth. And so you have the MSG with the Severi sensor, which has been used by the Germans to detect the source. And then you have more the Japanese satellite with a MODIS type sensor. And the European, the Belgian group is a fantastic group which has used the IAZ sensor to detect the source. Then finally, you can implement an instrument on the space station because it's rotating over the Earth. And in fact, the light instrument, installed on the space station in 94, it was measuring only the aerosol for 90. This is a LIDAR. And I think I am the only one which has used data from this instrument. And it was crucial to show how the model was developed by NASA was able to represent, to simulate correctly the vertical profile of aerosol from Africa and from China. Finally, there is tomorrow a launch by an EMIS instrument, which is dedicated to measure the soil mineralogy over all the source. So this is the pioneer. I will go by the pioneering work first. The first paper is by Prospero, and it was published in 1970. And so this is showing a snapshot of the Environmental Science Service Administration, which the future NOAA, from the polar orbiting satellite ESA 5, showing the dust storm from South Algeria. You have here the west coast of Africa. Okay, Senegal is here. You have Western Sahara here. And you see this gray shade. This is a dust storm. And you are here in Algeria. Mauritania is here. And so you have this clearly this dust storm forming in Algeria and moving over the Atlantic. And then on this paper, Prospero and his colleagues show that this dust was coming over the Caribbean, and later they showed that it was coming over the US. So this was the first time in 1967 that they discovered that dust over the Caribbean was coming from Africa. Meanwhile, before that, they thought that this was pristine area, the Caribbean, where they could detect cosmic dust, but unfortunately they were measuring dust from Africa. And so using a later satellite, the TOMS, Joe and myself and colleagues, we identify global major dust source and show that they are not everywhere like we saw before, but they are located in preferentially in depression. The second, so this is the silver medal. So Prospero was gold, this is the silver. This is using satellite photo to follow an East Asian dust storm in April 69. So this is China, and you have different deserts here. You have the Taklamak Desert, which is a huge desert north of Tibet. This is the Tibetan Plateau, and it's surrounded by mountains. It's a depression, so the winds are the dynamics is very particular. But the dust storm was associated with a low system here. You see the line of this perturbation. And the yellow is surrounding the Lost Plateau, where there was an accumulation of sand for millions of years, and the Ordos Desert. And you see here this gray is the dust storm that you can really follow here on the April 69. So this was the first paper showing that low system pressure creates a dust storm over China. Later, Sun Lingang published indicated that there was, of course, dust from natural desert, but also there were new desertification, which cover about 15 to 90% of the original desert and may generate more dust storm ranging from 10 to 40%. So anthropogenic dust associated with natural dust are have to be taken into account. So this is the bronze medal, witness 74, which you who used satellite photo with back trajectory to trace back dust in Antarctica. So this is Antarctica, Australia, South America, Patagonia. And he used a Nimbus photo to show that dust was coming to Antarctica. Okay, this is very important, Antarctica, because it's darkening the snow. So you have an increase of snow melt, but also Antarctica is the subject of ice core, where they've measured for 400,000 years the amount of dust over time. And so the last glacial maximum 20,000 years ago was very dusty. And so the question was, where was coming from this dust? And so you have different techniques. The satellite was not giving a full picture. So there was other technique, the radiogenic isotope proposed by, in fact, Pierre Biscay and Francis Grousset and Alois Borry with Il-Nil. And then satellite data were used by Santiago Gasso and Ariel Stein, and he published several papers. And I had a student who looked at that with a model and satellites. And for modeling, we had a bunch of papers and trajectory analysis to find out where in this continent dust was coming from, either South America or Australia. The answer is mostly from South America, because there was exposed continental shelf all the way to the Falkland Islands during last glacial maximum, during glacial period. And so the final pioneer work is here over the US, and this is using, they didn't say which instrument, which satellite it is, but they show six dust plume of the Western Mojave Desert, with Landsat, so NASA satellite in 73, and they identify the cause of erosion, and it's due to land use change. So this is the first paper showing the importance of land use change. And so later, using MODIS satellite data, myself, Joe Prospero, Tom Gill, and colleagues, we identify globally all sources with anthropogenic origin. Okay, so this was the pioneering work. Now let's go to the actual sensor which have been used to detect the source. I have to look at my clock to know where I am. Okay, so I will speak about the AVHRR TOMS MODIS and tomorrow this instrument EMIT, which will be launched. Here is a photo from yesterday. You see the SpaceX rocket ready to launch. So it will be launched in 12 hours exactly if everything goes as predicted. So let's start with AVHRR. So these are seasonal mean value of aerosol optical thickness, which is giving you the extinction of light through an aerosol. So the higher the value, the higher the extinction of light at the surface. Okay. So when you see and the value of optical depth. So when you have a value, an optical depth of one, it means that you reduce the light at the surface by a factor 2.7 or 3. Okay. So you have a reduction of light of factor 3 when it's one. And so you have a value here of red, it's 0.5. So here you have a concentration of aerosol in winter. And you see that it's moving north to about 20 degrees north. Okay, and this, and then you have a second plume here south of here. And so we can identify the origin of this plume. So this is biomass burning, savanna fires. This is dust from West Africa. And so because the convergence zones between the North Hemisphere and the South Hemisphere is shifting with season, this dust plume is shifting too. And south of it, so this convergence zone, it occupies the northern position in summer and a southern position in winter. And south of it, you have a lot of convective clouds, precipitating cloud, producing a large reduction. Oops. So this paper by Hussar, Prospero, and Stowe, there is no D here, published in 97, produced the first global seasonal map of aerosol optical thickness, okay? And so from this paper, it was clear that, so this dust plume was reaching the Caraiman, which is here, and further going to south, the southern states of the United States. And so it was, that's published in a seminal paper by Prospero and Carlson in 1972. This latitudinal shift is a key factor to test model. So a model simulating dust should be able to reproduce correctly this seasonal change. And so, as I mentioned, that dust can provide nutrients to land. And this is a question about the Amazon basin and how much dust from West Africa is affecting, is providing nutrients, because the topsoil of the Amazon is very shallow. And so it was, there is a constant discussion about how much is coming from that. And so you see in winter, it's coming over the Amazon. So this is possible. So the second instrument is TOMS. I am not going into the detail, but so this instrument was launched to measure ozone, because ozone is, as you know, absorbing in the ultraviolet and can photodissociate in the ultraviolet, but they are aerosol absorbing in the ultraviolet, in particularly dust, but also black carbon, okay? And so German in 97, suggest to use this formula, this aerosol index AI, using this formula to detect dust. And this is showing an image of this aerosol index. Sorry, the number of days this aerosol index is greater than a certain value. And you have a maximum here associated with dust from West Africa and from the savanna fires, because the savanna fires producing black and brown carbon. So, Joe Prospero has been looking at TOMS data. So the launch of TOMS was 1979. And so since the 1980s, Joe has been looking at this dust. At this TOMS aerosol index in the 90s, sorry. And so he found that there was a recurrent characteristic of it. And so with myself, Tom Gill, and the TOMS science team member, We try to see if we could detect where they are, if they were located in preferential area and which characteristics. And so Joe suggests to use this daily gridded TOMS aerosol index, which is about 100 kilometers by 125 kilometers at the equator, and suggests to calculate the frequency of occurrence that this TOMS aerosol is greater than an arbitrary value. It doesn't matter. But so you have to find the right signal, because if it's 2 weeks and you detect, you have dust everywhere, so you have to find the right way, the right value. And so over 30 years of Nimbus 7, we were able to figure out where are the major hotspots. A problem of the TOMS AI is its low resolution. And so 100 kilometers, the risk that you have clouds within 100 kilometers is very high. Also, it's arid region. So, and the other problem is impossible to separate different absorbing aerosol like dust and black carbon and brown carbon. Anyway, so this is a figure coming from the paper published in 2002 in Review of Geophysics, and the ISO line is showing the number of days that the TOMS aerosol index is greater than one. So the darkest the line, the more dust and higher dust value it is. And the highest dust value, or the highest frequency of dust storm, dust event, is over what's called a depression. The bodily depression. The topography is represented in color. So dark green means a depression. What you see in the white, this is the Tibetan plateau, is a 5,000 meter, right? And the brown here, orange, is mountains. So the first thing you see immediately is that the maxima of this TOMS aerosol index is located in depression. And so this was a key factor. So, in addition, this source were flooded during the Pleistocene, and now, so they are rich during the Pleistocene, they were flooded, and it's like a pond of a lake which turned dry. It's full of clay and fine dust particles. When it's dry, it can be uplifted. In addition, this region received runoff and bring fresh sediment to lakes and playa. The largest dust source in the world is the bodily depression right here, and in Chad and Niger, and most dust sources are located in regions that are essentially uninhabited. Most dust models now incorporate this factor in some way and with improved performance. So knowing that the source were preferentially located in topographic depression with geomorphological characteristics and were often associated with paleolithic global dust modeler, started to adapt their models to take these new findings into account. It results in a major model improvement. And so these are the three studies developing this source, and it's still now used by, if not all, practically all the models, dust models. So myself, Prospero, Gide, and so on, we published this paper in 2001 using topographic depression, and this is giving you the value of this function. And then Charlie Zender and his colleagues probably both do use the geomorphologic basins, and then Inate again and colleagues use paleolithics. Now, the third instrument I want to speak is the MODIS Deep Blue Aerosol Product. So the MODIS is an instrument specifically dedicated to measure aerosol. Okay, this is the first time an instrument is dedicated to measure aerosol. This instrument measures the globe on one day. It has been launched since the first. There are two instruments on two satellites. One is called Terra and the other Aqua. The first was on Terra and it was launched in 1999 with measurements since 2000. This is ridiculous. It's still going on. I don't know why I put a seven here. And then Aqua was launched in 2002 with measurements available in 2003 to present. So this Terra instrument provides data for 22 years. This is extraordinary. It's still turning. And so it provides a value at, it, in fact, the pixel is 1 kilometer, but they aggregate that into 10 kilometers. And I use a deep blue product because dust is absorbing in the blue more than in the green and the red. And so it's a very interesting instrument to for dust retrieval. So the major improvement relative to the terms is high spatial resolution. So from 100 kilometers at the equator, we go now to 10 kilometers. So it's a factor 10 improvement. On the other, and you have two instruments. One is flying at 10:30 a.m., the other at 1:30 p.m. So you have twice the resolution to capture development of dust events. So this long-term record, 22 years for this one and 19 for this one, allow to create very robust statistics, okay? And the spectral variation of the optical property allow to separate dust from other aerosol because dust is more absorbing in the near UV than the visible. So if you know this the value at these different wavelengths, you are able to figure out if it's dust or another one. So they use also the same algorithm to retrieve optical depth or using CWIFs, which was launched in 97, but stopped in 2010. I will not speak about that. So this aerosol optical depth from the NASA team, in particular, Christina Shu and Andy Sayer, I have used this data. So they provide all this information, but strangely, they didn't provide what we need as a dust model, which is dust optical depth. We don't need all the aerosol. We just want the extinction of light by dust, not sulfate, not CISO, not organics, just dust. And surprisingly, they didn't provide that. So I developed an algorithm to retrieve that. So, and it's very simple. So the first algorithm published in 2010. And so, my aerosol, so what they measure for in the instrument is dust optical depth. If I have this more absorption in the blue than in the red, 670, and that's the deep blue cat, 412 nanometer, it's the wavelength. And then there is a parameter called Angstrom exponent, which is very sensitive to the size distribution. The lower this value, the more larger the particle. For molecule, it's about 4. For fine particle like sulfate, it's about 2. And for dust, it's less than 0.5, 0.3. And if you have only dust with particle larger than 1 micron, it's even negative. And so, but there was a problem. This is like a switch. So I have either it's true or false. So it's not a continuous value. And working with some colleagues, I try to figure out another function which is more continuous. And so I have used this function, which is based on observation, and provide you continuous value of dust optical depth only if there is absorption. If there is no absorption at all, in the blue, it means it's not dust, because we know dust is brown, it's absorbing in the blue. So the possibility that dust is not in contact with the surface is a problem, because if you want to know the dust source, you need to have the dust from the surface. But sometimes it's over the surface, it's over the boundary layer. And so in a paper in 2020, we addressed this problem and using a LiDAR canopy. So this is the comparison of this source inventory from MODIS in shading, orange shading, and then the TOMS in blue and the green OMI, aerosol index. And so you see the bodily depression here, all the peaks in the Mali, the Tunisia, here in Arabian Peninsula, the Tar Basin, the Taklamakan that I mentioned and measure, and then the Gobi Desert and the Lake Erie region, the Patagonia. Here you have the Chihuahua Desert, also Mojave Desert in California, and so on. So the key of this paper we published in 2012 is to determine how much is natural and non-anthropogenic. To do that, I've used a land use data set, and knowing my dust optical depth over the globe, and knowing how much land use there is on the surface, I overlay them and said, aha, here I know how much natural. 75% of dust over the world is natural, so no anthropogenic, no human activities, and 25% is anthropogenic. The blue is natural and the green. And so you see it's Sahel where you have agricultural agriculture, farmland, pasture, rangeland. And in Australia, it's mostly rangeland, and the same here in the high plains of the US and Patagonia, it's mostly rangeland. So I can calculate by continents and the dust emission for the different continents. North Africa, for example, is 92% natural, 80% anthropogenic, but in some continents like Australia, it's essentially anthropogenic. There are other techniques. So the German group with Kerstin Skepansi have used the geostationary satellite with a Severi sensor to detect the source. And they find also a peak in the bodily depression. And then in Mali, you have another maxima. So it's the results are relatively similar. The problem of this method is that it's limited to the DRA zoom that where the geostationary satellite is zooming. You cannot have the global value there. In addition, it's using the infrared, and infrared means that it's dependent on the temperature, the surface temperature there. So there is a lot of problem there. And so they have to work hard to figure out how to solve this. So finally, I will go quickly. I don't have time here. I'm close to the end. The different techniques. So there is the inverse model. So this work was pioneering by Oleg Dubovic, who is now in Lille. He is a very active, very dynamic person. And it was spurred by another very dynamic person who unfortunately died a long time ago now, by Joram Kaufmann. And so this work suffered by the lack of data. So the idea was so instead of solving the prognostic equation of mass conservation for dust, you impose the emission, okay? You have the source, you impose the emission, and you solve where are your dust and where it goes and where it removes. Here you inverse it. I know where is my dust from the satellite. I want to know how much there is from the source. That's called an inversion. And so Oleg was pioneering in doing this work, and they was following a study in 2012 and by the Japanese, and that's the group of Oleg in 2019, because initially they didn't have data over that surface. Okay. And then another technique which is widely used is back trajectory model. Okay, so you measure some dust at one point anywhere in the globe, and you can, knowing the winds, it's possible to backtrack in time to know where is this dust, where this dust was coming from. And the most widely used is the NOAA ice split model. And so, which was developed by people at NOAA. And in particular, Draxler came to me and said, why don't we use this modest dust optical depth that you retrieve to know. So I know the frequency of occurrence of dust event over any part of the world at 10 kilometer resolution. And I know my surface winds at the same resolution. Then I know what is the minimum winds that I need to have dust out of in the atmosphere. Okay, and this technique was used, and he was able to retrieve this threshold of friction velocity. This was the first attempt to use satellite data to retrieve this friction velocity. And it matched relatively well previous in-situ data by Gillette and Passy. So I have to go fast. This is another technique by Bing Pu, who is a professor at Kansas University. She worked with me at GFDL to use this modest, the same idea that Drexler and extended to the globe. And then now I will speak about another technique. It's geomorphology of peri-inferential dust source. So you measure your, you have your hotspots, okay? And you said, aha, I have a dust source. but a confirmation could come from geomorphology, because there is specific geomorphological characteristic of this dust source, okay? And the pioneering work is by Joanna Buller at Loughborough University, Matt Baddock and others, who propose to use land surface classification to determine the location and temporal behavior of preferential dust source. The geomorphologic type and connectivity, because you have different type, like an ephemeral lake, but you need sand dunes to create this sandblasting process. And so this method was applied by Matt Baddock, myself, and colleagues over the Chihuahua Desert that you have here. This is Texas border, this is Mexico, this is New Mexico. And the colors, the shading correspond to different geomorphological characteristics. So the blue are ephemeral lakes, and the contour, the red contour correspond to the peak, the number of days per year, the dust optical depth is greater than whatever. So a reduction pretty much of a 2.5 of solar radiation at the surface. So this is very dense. And the most densest area located each time, you see blue and yellow sand dunes, ephemeral lakes. So clearly dust source have a geomorphological signature, and this is a proof. And also this is a way to evaluate and test your dust source inventory. And this is the only test which has been done that I know of. Another thing is the isotopic signature. This, okay, the dust has, so this is coming from Pierre Biscay, he's really the father of this. So in fact, the you have radiogenic isotope which decay, and if you take their ratio with the stable isotope, for example, you take strontium 87 relative to the strontium 86 and neonidium, you can characterize the origin of this dust. And so this is a work by Pourmont, who was working with Joe Prospero and published in Geology in 2020. So they measure this ratio of neonidium and strontium and neonidium here, knowing the value of the over different regions of Africa, Egypt, Senegal, Sub-Sahara, Bodele, and so on, Mali and Libya. They can figure out where was this dust coming from two different periods, winter and summer. Okay, so a problem is you see the value over the source area are too large, so it's very difficult to figure out exactly where it's coming from. But in some case, so this is high temporal variability. So this was by Francis Grousset, and he was measuring this two ratio strontium and neonidium in the Alps, and generally dust in the Alps, which is here, is coming from West Africa, okay? But he contacted me because he said, okay, Paul, I found that the value on that particular day, which is March 6, 1999, is coming from Asia. Is that possible? And so we worked together, and indeed. So the storm traveling 20,000 kilometers, 2 weeks from China. And Francis Grousset and his team were able to say that particular day, dust was coming from China and not Africa. I mean, this is quite amazing. And so there are many work here, but okay. So I work with the Prospero group and try to figure out if I could do that with our model. And so I reproduced exactly, they gave me the value of the different the ratio over the different parts of Africa, and knowing I could simulate what's called a tagging. I simulate dust from different regions, and then I have the value from the different region over, this is the North Atlantic, and each color corresponds of dust from different region. So you see a peak here at Barbados in summer and it's decreasing. And so knowing that the origin of the dust from this different region and the characteristic isotopic characteristic, and can calculate the value over Barbados. And you see a shift, I don't get the same value, but the uncertainty is huge. So it's not very certain, we need more value, but this is a fantastic test. So anthropogenic dust source, I am going, I will have to skip this. Mineralogical signature, the mineralogy. So dust has, mineralogy is very important to tell you what are the elements, the composition of dust, okay? So you want to know, for example, if you have iron, calcite, feldspar, because that's what this element will have an importance in dust interaction with radiation. And the amount of iron, for example, is crucial for absorption. The darker the dust, the more iron you have in the dust. So, and it's absorbing, it's almost like a greenhouse gas dust. On the other hand, when it's free of any iron, it's scattering like sulfate, so it's cooling the atmosphere. And we use constant value of this by the model. So this is very bad. It's very bad because we don't have the right data. So there were different group of people, Clarkin with Yves Balkanowski in France, Slobodan and Nikovic group, and Journet, they provide global inventory of topsoil mineralogy, which is great, but it depends on the FAO soil map, which is horrible. So in this totally, I would say, I could show you, you see the border between countries, and suddenly the minerals between two countries change, it doesn't make sense. But, so what we have now is EMIT launched tomorrow, and so it will reduce the largest uncertainty of dust radiative effect, which is related to the soil abundance of iron oxide. This was published by Long Lee, working with Nathalie Mahoral at Cornell University. And the culprit is soil maps, which are highly uncertain, if not totally wrong, that's my personal opinion, in desert area. So hopefully the Earth's surface mineral dust source investigation due to launch at Cape Canaveral tomorrow in 12 hours will provide global distribution of key mineral over the source. So I will not go in the detail of that, and I will conclude. I didn't speak about this, but Abup, maybe you don't know that, but when you have convective clouds over hot surface, it's precipitating, and when you have evaporation of this precipitating large convective cloud, this thunderstorm, it evaporates, cool the surface, but the surface is very hot, and so you have a very strong wind between the cold and hot air, and it uplifts dust in wall of dust, and it's very characteristic of Arabian Peninsula. That's why it has an Arabic name, but you find that everywhere. You find that in Arizona, and this Abup shut down the Phoenix airport regularly, and it's very, nobody really cares about that, because it's very difficult to detect them from space, because they are associated with mesoscale convective clouds, with thunderstorms, and this satellite instrument, even LiDAR, cannot penetrate to this cloud. They mask out clouds. So this is a real problem. But there is a group at, I think they are Oxford, Ashpole and Washington, who developed an automatic detection method. And I think that's very fantastic if they could extend that beyond West Africa and summer. Another aspect which is not studied, and I was proud to know, this is just published in Nature by Rodriguez and others, where they show that biogenic crust is covering 12% of land surface, but it's totally ignored by the modeling community. Okay, and here EMIT could help. Flooding. We assume that these dust sources are constant and dry, but actually it can be flooded. And so Nathalie Mahoral with Rob Bryant and others have studied that the fluctuation of these dust sources and how much they are reduced during flooding. And then you have an increased emission by apport of new sediments. So you have a time variability. The threshold of friction velocity control the frequency of dust storm. And this is an aspect which is totally ignored by models. So they will tell you, oh, we reproduce perfectly the dust optical depth. But it depends if you have continuous, the weak dust optical depth or one big event So this is the major difference between Africa and Asia, and it's ignored by the model. So this should be included. Mineralogical composition is controlling the amplitude of dust interaction with Earth's climate system, but global inventory are very uncertain, and we have very big hope with EMIC data. Finally, land use and climate change modulate the source and should be considered in climate model, which is tricky because you need Earth system model and it's extremely heavy models. And you should include wildfire, which are more and more frequent. Many studies have been conducted on the effect of dust on rainfall, but only a few have been extended to consider feedback to vegetation change. Thank you very much. That's it. And I took too much time, sorry. I'm sorry, okay? Okay, now I have to go back. Maybe you are
Paul.
I don't see you. Okay, now I see you.
Paul, thanks a lot for this extraordinary, exceptional presentation. I'm so
Thank
glad
you,
that we got you today. I have to say just a small digression. We started our modeling work in Belgrade using so-called Ginoux mask. So it continues for years. We modified a bit later, but this was our starting point, by the way. Now, gets back to the questions. And I will have a few questions in front of me, maybe Stelios, if we have time, of course. Sarah, you are the boss here, but I hope that we can have maybe five.
In the chat, there is a short comment from Hugh.
Yes.
Get pointing one day, one information in your presentation, Paul. Quick correction to your slide. In October 2017, on board of Sentinel 5, Trobomi.
The history?
It's not yet in the air. It's also polar.
Trobomi.
Not just stationary. Take care.
What? This one? No.
Yeah, the
Trobomi. Yeah, I didn't mention Trobomi. So that's the
Yeah. Then I will pass the floor to Stelios. It was just because in the chat there were this comment and it then Stelios.
Yes. We'll try to have this 10 minutes more for people that would like to listen to the answers for these questions. And I will start from Zamber and Stud that is asking why is dust why the limit of dust is considered to be less than 20 micrometers? I mean, what is the-
Why? In a model? Because the gravitational settling is too fast. For climate, maybe for air quality, it's important, but for climate, no, because it will even not cross one grid cell, so we don't include that. And so to be more precise, but then it's for numerical experts. So you have condition to resolve this equation of advection, because it's an advection problem. There is what's called the Courant-Frédéric-Lévy condition, and you will have to do extremely short time step to simulate this sedimentation properly, and it's totally excluded in a climate model where you need to be able to simulate the criterion for a climate model. It's 10 years per day. And so if you have a time step of a microsecond, you can't do that.
Okay. Then Santiago Gasso is asking if there are any plans to use EMIT to observe dust clouds, for example, dust in suspension as opposed to soils, and if there is a team involved in this task.
So EMIT will avoid dust plume. Sorry, Santiago. The idea is to measure the surface. So we'll avoid the plume like pest, like plague.
I think this answers half of the question of the next anonymous attendee. And the second half of the question is, what are the lower limits of these satellites that sample aerosols? Are they able to measure background concentration of dust aerosols in the remote troposphere, for example?
Oh, what is the background value? It depends on the instrument. So for example, Calliope, so it's a LiDAR, so the width of the signal is very narrow, as you can imagine. And so it's really like a curtain. But it can go to very low value of dust extinction because it measures the depolarization ratio. And so you can tune this number to detect dust. So you can go very low value. Now, in terms of absolute value from this instrument, it's very uncertain. It's not the best instrument to retrieve absolute value of extinction. So for instrument like MODIS, so what is the limit? So the error is about 0.22. Multiplied by the optical depth. It cannot be used for background atmosphere because that's the minimum value is about 0.02 that I know, or 0.01, and the uncertainty of satellite retrieval is larger than that, so it cannot work.
There is a question from Nick Middleton asking if the results of this 2012 paper estimating the anthropogenic dust as 25% is still reliable. I think you skipped this slide, but maybe you can just answer.
Yeah, thank you for the question. I think that's a great question. Because an uncertainty in this work was to use the land use data set from HIDE, HYDE. And it was an older version called 2, and now there are 3.2 version. And so it has changed totally the distribution of this land use. For example, they have a new category now called rangeland. Before it was cropland and pasture. And I was very skeptical of this data set, for example, over the empty quarter in the southern part of Saudi Arabia. It's called empty quarter because it's sand dune and nobody lives there. And they had huge value, had to show huge value on land use. It doesn't make any sense. There is nobody there. I know that some people go there for the weekend and have barbecue and they go back immediately in their house because you cannot stay there. So I knew that this high two has a lot of error. So new, I should write a short paper. In fact, I was working with Martina Close, who was working at BSC with Carlos Perez and others to look at this problem. But she's now busy she's leading a new lab. And so I'm not sure she will take that paper over. Otherwise, I will do it because it's a very interesting question. And you are totally right, Nick. I should modify this and update the value because it's 10-year-old. Yeah.
Estelios, I'm taking care of the chat, and there is a question that maybe Paul wants to answer that is coming from Chichen, and it's related.
Oh, yeah, I know him. Yeah, he's working with me. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's related with Haboobs. He or she, I'm not sure, is asking, when you are simulating Haboobs, should we consider the thermal effects introduced by the dust in the air, or the LM is sufficient to count these impacts?
So in fact, Chichen is now in China. He was working at GFDL with the SJ Lin group. We developed this state-of-the-art vector scheme. And so we decide to see if we could simulate Haboob with, I'm not sure, she would have to correct me, but I think at 8 kilometer resolution, we were able to simulate properly Haboob with this model. And so it didn't include this interactive effect, this feedback. So I think, there are more work to do, but the work with she is too bad that he left for China, because now it's very difficult to collaborate together. I wish him the best, of course. But this was very promising work. And hopefully we can continue. Also, it's difficult between two far away countries.
Zamberend is coming back to the question about the size. And I think we had in this seminar actually three presentations, one from Zamberend, one from Claire Ryder, and one from Jasper Cook, that more or less that's the subject of having having observed larger dust particles and implications that we have also in radiative forcing. But I will not go back to this question. We can just discuss it by yourselves if you want. And because
we who is asking this question, Jasper Cook?
Parents too. The thing is that he presented, and there are several papers now that very large dust particles have been observed really far away from the sources, up to 500 micrometers. So in his question
and comment, I think that's anecdotal, and for climate it has no interest. It may be interest because it's exotic, but it's obvious. I mean, there are papers showing size distribution, in-situ observation, and you have beyond 20 micrometer, it's 50 micrometer, you don't find anything. So Hal Maring, for example, who was working with Joe Prospero, measured the size distribution at Cap Verde, which is on the west coast of Africa, and Barbados. And the size distribution doesn't change except beyond 50 micrometer. So I don't think for climate it's very relevant. Of course, if you are in a haboob and you are in West Africa, for air quality it's very important, but for climate, so over the ocean, all this large area without dust source are not very influenced by this large particle. So I am personally, I'm not going to include that. But it's true that Jasper Cook from UC Irvine showed the importance of the larger particle in the, because radiatively the size is very important. And so he has shown some paper showing that the model underestimates the larger particles, but overestimates small particles, and this affects the amount of interaction with shortwave radiation. And now it's more shifting to long wave radiation, but this is very technical. I'm not sure how people interpret
that description. Okay. I don't know if we have time to continue. Maybe we can read two more questions. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's the last webinar before the summer break. Then we can give 15 minutes more if the people is still here.
I'm sorry, Sarah.
We are so strict with the time, but today is a special day because most of the people is on holidays. I can assume.
Cool.
And there is a woman called Isabel Ginoux that is raising the hand. I don't know if she wants to do a clapping or she wants to say something. If you want to say something, please type in the chat, okay? And if it's needed, we can promote you and give you voice. Then just write me through chat, because I don't know if it's a mistake or clapping or you. Estelle, you can continue, sorry.
So what are the questions?
I guess it's not really a question. So I will go back to the question and answer window. And there are two questions related with MODIS. One has to do about GOES and MODIS. GOES has a lower spatial resolution than MODIS. So the question is if we can use MODIS instead of GOES to detect dust in the Western Hemisphere, mainly in the US.
Sorry, if what? If we could use those
for.
We
use MODIS instead of GOES to detect dust in the Western Hemisphere, mainly in the US.
And I don't understand the question. So to use MODIS, but how we use MODIS? To complement GOES with MODIS. That's the question.
Yeah, probably something like that. Well, the attendee tries to point out that MODIS has higher spatial resolution, so it has to be used in order to improve what only GOES can provide, something like this, I can.
Yeah, it's basically claiming that GOES has better temporal resolution. Then why they don't put on board of GOES the MODIS sensor to have better spatial and temporal representation? You know?
Yeah, you can do all kind of mixing of instrument. We have Gikas, who was at BSC, who did a lot of work and proposed new data sets. So yeah, I present one data set, but we have now way more data sets available. So and anyway, NASA is going to stop MODIS instrument. So they are turning towards VIRS and TIRS and new instruments. So MODIS is the end. They will use the last remaining of fuel to make it crash. And so it's not an additional object flying around the Earth. So what is the last question?
Sarah, you can pick it. Maybe. Yeah, okay, I can
just choose one. Yes. It's up to you.
One question.
There are many questions that we will send you, Paul. No worries.
Yes. One question is that many of the dust emitting regions are the same regions where fire occurs. And there is an increasing evidence of smoke containing significant amounts of terrigenous material. So what do you think of the importance of this discovery and whether it would take much work to incorporate this into the models?
Yeah, indeed. The Kerstin Skipanski in Germany did a lot of work on the subject, and Natalie Immerwald also from Cornell, because this dust is very rich in iron, and so it can produce, and brown carbon can produce nutrient for the ocean biogeochemistry. So yeah, we are working on that with Yan Yu, my former colleague who is now at Beijing University. And so we first start by looking at the satellite data. It's better to start with observation to constrain model. So after this paper, we are going to look at that with the model. We do have dynamic fire in the model, actually, in GFDM model. And we do, so it's in the CMIP 6. If you are interested, look at that. The GFDM model output of dust is coming also from fires. Because in the land model, they have fire, so it burns vegetation. And when the surf, the vegetation is low enough, so there is no green and brown vegetation, so it's burned, then dust is emitted. So if this person is interested, it's available. It's publicly available from CMIP 6. So you have the full historical run and then for the future different scenario, SSP scenario. So yeah. I should look at that myself too. So thank you very much, Sarah, Stobanan, and for the work there and the invitation.
I need to prepare some clamming after the talk of the speaker, because with no people around it's really strange sometimes. To thanks a lot your time and appreciate a lot that you accept the invitation, Paul. It was really nice talk and seminar. And I can tell you that there were connected more than 100 people today. Then this one of the most top of the year followed webinars. And we will send you all the pending questions. And of course, you can contact Paul if you want to ask him directly any question. I think that he will be happy to answer you. I hope so. And to keep
my email. My email is paul.ginoux@noaa.gov. It's easy.
It's very easy to catch you. Yeah. And thanks a lot to Stelios and Mitsko and Slodovan for being here today. That is the last webinar before the summer break. And now I will take the role of just sharing my screen. If you don't mind, Paul, I will
stop sharing. Yeah.
Yeah, I will take my. And just I want to remind you that you have, we are doing the advertisement of the webinars through the Twitter of the Barcelona Regional Center. Then please follow us. Or you have the option to subscribe to the newsletter of the center. For if you go to the website, you can find very easily a button for subscribing to the newsletter. We are announcing the upcoming events or news that you can be more interested. Then you will receive it regularly. And again, for those of you that are asking me all the time if the webinars are recorded and publicly available, just go to this website of the Barcelona Regional Center, go to resources, and here you will have a section called webinars, and you can find all the webinars of all our speakers after a few days, also the slides. And someone is asking us in through the chat about modeling, DAS modeling. Keep in mind that here there are very interesting webinars. Some of them are related with how we can modeling mineralogy, for example, like the one from Maria Gonzalez or Carlos Perez. But also there is the nice first talk coming from Slodovan about everything related with DAS modeling. Then we are having seminars related with modeling. Please go and check. But also you have the training schools that we are organizing, and all the materials are here in the past events. Then with this last tip about resources, I want to mention that we will restart the webinars in September. Probably the first date will be 5th September. I need to final confirm the title and the speaker, but be aware through Twitter and the newsletter about upcoming events. And with it, I wish you a nice summer, a relaxed summer, recover energy during these next weeks. And hope to see you in September.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks a lot again, Paul, and Nitsko and Astelios. Bye.